Jesus warns us not to be deceived. Matthew 24:4, Jesus answered unto them, take heed that no man deceive you. For many shall come in my name, saying, I am Christ, and shall deceive many. 2 Timothy 3:13, but evil men and seducers wax worse and worse, deceiving and being deceived. So that's the plot of the devil, to deceive God's very elect. And let's set God short in the time. The Bible says even the very elect shall be deceived.
Right.
How many times has holiness become a question mark in your mind? How many times has what you've been preached for the last 50 years in your life that you've heard that you believe is right become a question mark? Because we see so much hypocrisy, we see so much tongue talking, we see so much compromise for our children, that if we say they're wrong, they're going to hell, what we believed years ago, and it puts a question mark in my mind. But I'm here to tell you, I am so convinced that it takes clean, sanctified, holy living to make it to heaven, that I will not be deceived if every one of my children denounce it. My wife walks away from it, and I even backslide. Holiness is still right. It's God's law. It's God's principle. And we've got to live it to make heaven our home. Don't you put a question mark in your spirituality, but you rebuke that devil and say, devil, come hell or high water, I'm going to live what God put in my heart to, and make it to heaven and fulfill God's plan.
Yes, that's right. Amen.
God has a plan. Number two, he tries to discourage the church. Something that causes loss of being optimistic, being positively minded. Now, I'm a realist. I see it and call it like it is, at home or at church. Some paint it, some pet it, and some pamper it, but I just see it for what it is. Amen to God, you can strip paint from a cabinet, you can sand paint off a casing, and it's steel wood up underneath that cabinet. It is what it is. But my friend, one thing if we ever got to do is keep a positive mind and keep encouraged in serving the Lord. We should never get discouraged when we come to church. Well, that preacher just preached a little too hard. I'm here to tell you, holiness has never been hard. The Word of God's never been discouragement. It's always been encouragement, whether it's blistered me or blessed me, because I know it was good for me. You hear what I'm saying? Every good Word of God is good for our soul. And I will not be discouraged if I have to preach to 15. I plan to keep a positive attitude. And maybe God will give me 15 more plus 15 to preach to. But if we go around making negative comments, go around being frustrated with lies, that's just a plot of the devil to destroy you. Keep your head down and your heart heavy. But I'm here to tell you, when I think about what God's done for me, I can't help but to shout, can't help but to praise the Lord. And where he's brought me from, I can't help but to thank God for bringing me out of the miry pit and planting my foot upon the rock and establishing my goings. I believe I've got too much to be encouraged for to get discouraged.
Oh, yes.
Amen.
One preacher said he preached on discouragement, and he got so discouraged preaching he quit and shut the books and said, let's go to the house. I'm here to tell you, it takes a whole lot more to discourage me. If everyone stayed at home and all I had was my family, I might get discouraged. But then I have to suck it up and get encouraged enough to preach to them.
Right.
Amen? Amen. I preach to them and one or two more. Many a times. Amen. Oh, my pew's getting empty. Well, get encouraged and do something about it and fill it up. Don't fall into the plot of the devil and walk around with your head hung and your heart heavy. But you tell him in the world and the devil how good your God is, and I'm going to shout all the way to heaven. I'm encouraged. If I got a servant by myself, if my wife don't come, my husband don't come, I'm encouraged. If I got to preach by myself, I'm encouraged. We got to go visiting by ourselves, I'm encouraged, because who my God is, people don't change my spirituality, because greater is he is some of the most discouraging work. Leaders plan things and people don't care. But you know what? I'm encouraged in who I am in God. Paul sat in prison. He didn't get the Mardi Gras. He got touched of the Holy Ghost and wrote the letters. Paul was on the island of Patmos blind, but then he got the Spirit on the Lord's day. I'm here to tell you, you can encourage yourself in the Lord and make heaven your home in spite of people and the devil. And someone say amen.
Amen.
Distractions. There's a world of distractions for the believer out there. And the devil will do all he can to give you right, you fall right into his plot and distract you. How many good Christian girls have we seen get distracted by ungodly, half-hearted, lukewarm, backslid, so-called Christian boys? How many good men, Christian young men, have we seen get distracted by a shape and a figure of another lady? Money distracts us, jobs distract us, and parties and fashions. And you can't hardly preach holiness no more because people got one eye on the world and one eye on the church and want to dress like the world more than they are trying to please God. But I despise that devil and that distractions. The Bible says demons have left me for the love of this present world. Something distracted him. Something caught his mind and his heart that he turned it around from serving God to following the world. If you aren't careful, that devil will bring distractions to your life. Discontentment, moody, unhappiness, or sad and moody dissatisfaction.
Yes.
Women, you got a moody man. Someone needs to say amen.
Amen.
My man's so moody, he don't know whether to stay in bed or get up.
That's right.
Women, we all get moody. Men, we all get moody. My mama told me I was one of the most moodiest fellas she ever knew. I said, you must not know my dad then. Amen to God, you wake up one morning and you're happy and you wake up next morning and you're sad.
Mom.
Discontent with life, discontent with yourself, discontent with the church. Discontent with the preacher. Preacher, discontent with the people. It's nothing but a plot of the devil.
Amen.
Right. We're all just moody. We're emotional. We're people. But it gets to a place where we're dissatisfied with everything that goes on in our lives and everything around us. We better look and see where it's really coming from. Is it just my genes or my personality or a bad day? Or can I dig a little deeper and see some spiritual onslaught from hell making me unhappy about everything? That's the devil's job, is to get you in his plot and make you discontent with everything. How many times you told your wife, I'll give you $500, you want $1,000? How many times has mama said, you got this big wheel, four-wheeler, and you want something else? Huh? You know, you call your wife mama too sometimes, don't you? Mama ain't happy, no one's happy. Yeah, she's my mama, as long as she cooks and does my laundry, I call her mama. Huh? Amen to God. But I ain't talking about that kind of discontentment and unhappiness. I'm talking about spiritual warfare.
Yeah.
To where nothing satisfies you. Right. You got a four-course meal, ribeye paid for, and a $100 bill slapped in your pocket. You still discontent. You riding down the road and singing the songs of Zion. You just can't seem to muster up no joy. It might be just a devil onslaught you and cause you to be discontent about everything. We need to wake up and say, God, what's your plan for my life? God has a plan. His plan is to give us his peace. His joy. My joy I give to you, not as the world gives. My peace I give unto you. Not as the world giveth. The joy of the Lord will cause you to shout when you got holes in your shoes, holes in your pocket, and holes in your billfold. The joy of the Lord caused you to shout when everyone else has a new outfit and you wore the same one for the last four Sunday mornings. The joy of the Lord caused you to shout when you wish you had a hot dog and all you got is beans and taters and them are good too. Amen. The joy of the Lord caused you to shout when you don't have no gas to go nowhere, but someone comes up and slips some money in your hand and says, thank God for being real to me. I mean to tell you, God's a good God and He gives us peace that passes all understanding, and I believe I walk in His plan instead of falling to the devil's plot. Amen. God has a plan for the foundations of the world. He predestinated every one of us to be saved. Do you believe in predestination and election? Yes, I do. I believe we've all been predestined to be saved. God planned, not willing that none should perish. It's what choice of plan you choose. Plan A or plan B? You got a predestined plan here. If you accept it, you got a ticket to heaven. Or plan B says, listen to the devil and go to hell. What plan do you choose? I believe I'll choose plan A, because I don't want to go to hell. God's already predestined for the foundation of the world, had a plan of salvation fulfilled, that I could be saved and go to heaven. I know some say predestined some to hell, predestined some to heaven. God don't predestine no one to hell. He's not willing that none should perish, but that all should come to repentance. It's your choice and your plan that you choose. Amen. Life in Christ is God's plan. For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in Him should not perish but have everlasting life. And God sent not a Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through Him might be saved. Thank God for God's plan.
Amen.
The devil's plot or God's plan?
Yes.
Jesus said, your father ate, said Paul, make the way to piano, bread in the wilderness and are dead. Our father's Moses. Said you ate that bread and it died. But I'm the bread of heaven. And you eat of me, you shall never die. Jesus had a plan to give His life upon the cross. That whosoever accepted that plan, simple plan of salvation, and partake of His bread. You mean I got to eat His bread? The Catholic said when you take Holy Communion, you eat the cracker, you're literally eating the body of Christ. No, every time you get up and read that Word of God, you get down and pray, you're eating the body of Christ. Every time you come to church, lift your hands, you're eating the body of Christ. Every time you say no to the devil, say yes to God, you're eating the body of Christ. You're living, you're alive in Christ, and He's living in you, and His Word's in you. Amen to God. I'm glad that I'm continually eating the body of Christ. It's fresh, it's never grows stale. It's never grow old, but it's fresh manna every morning. It's fresh show bread every Sabbath day. And thank God I'm still eating and I'm alive. This old body may die, but my spirit will be alive. Paul said to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. He said, I'm in the strength to stay and to go. To stay and be your gift, but for me to go, it will be my gain. So when you don't feel like you're alive, just get some bread and start eating.
Amen.
Open the Word of God. It's God's plan to man.
Yes, praise God.
Jeremiah 29:11, I'm closing with this. It says, I know the thoughts I think towards you, saith the Lord. What does God really think about us? What does He think towards us? Thoughts of peace,
right.
Not of evil,
right.
To give you an expected end. He was telling Israel this after their 70 years of Babylonian captivity. He was saying, you might have thought I was hard letting you go there, but you know what? Amen, the thoughts I think to you aren't bad. They're good, and I got an expected end for you. People hated on the Jews their whole history. People have put them down, but you know what? The Jews are going to rise again. The Jews are going to be supreme again. They're God's chosen people. People are trying to stomp them out. Nations are trying to push them down. But every time they do, God knows they're expecting Him. The devil's trying to push you down. He's trying to tear up your home. But He knows they're expecting Him. He knows that all good things work together for them that love the Lord and are called according to His purpose. I just want to fulfill God's plan for my life because He knows my expected end. Can we stand our feet this morning? Thank God for the Holy Ghost. The devil has a plot, but God has a plan. Amy, the devil wants to drag you and your family to hell, but God has a plan to take you to heaven. I'm glad He knows my expected end. The thoughts of me are peace, not of evil. The Bible says He's angry with the wicked every day, but He looks down on His redeemed and He smiles. The choice is yours. Will you fall to the plot of the devil? Will you be another casualty? And I promise you, He has a secret underlying plot for each and every one of our lives. And it's up to us just to stay in God's plan. Brother Thomas, I've tripped. I fall. I've skinned my knees. I've been knocked down. But thank God I've never been knocked out. I've got back up. I've gathered my thoughts. Bible says the righteous man will fall 7 times, but he'll get back up. And he'll keep on going. Because you know what? That devil thought he had me. But thank God, God had a plan to keep me. Woo! He that keepeth Israel neither slumbers nor sleeps. He's not on a journey, not on a vacation. I always say, if you want to be kept, God can and will keep you. Because you keep your hand in the hand of the unseen God that will lead us and guide us all the way to heaven. Woo! Are you in God's plan? Or are you out of God's plan? Are you saved? Or are you unsaved? Are you on your way to heaven? Are you on your way to hell? There's no in between. What about it this morning? If you're lost, Jesus Christ wants to save your soul. Don't be deceived. Don't get discouraged. Don't get discontented. But you keep yourself in the plan, in the mind, in the Word of God. God made it, and He overcome, and so shall we overcome. Is there one here this morning who said, "Preacher, I've been fighting hell, and I just need the church to help me pray"?